morning students. So today let us see the video which I am going to record on module 5, which is determinants and eigenvalues and eigenvectors. So this is a part of linear algebra. So module 4 was been covered in the college about vector spaces. So module 5, I assume that you people already you have learned most of the things of module 5 in the mathematics subject. So the same thing has been even recalled in linear algebra. Okay, so what we are going to learn in module 5 here? So first thing is we are going to look what is determinants. We are going to learn what are the properties of determinants, and then we'll see what is permutations in matrices, and then we'll see what is cofactors, how to find cofactors, and using cofactors how to find out the determinant is what we are going to learn in the beginning. And then we will be learning on eigenvalues and eigenvectors. So we will be looking into some problems on how to find out the eigenvalues in using matrices, and then we will see how to find out the eigenvectors, and then we will keep our step into the diagonalization of the matrix. So we will see how to form the diagonalization of a given matrix, and then we will see some problems performing the matrices operation so that we can find out the diagonalization of any given matrix. And then we will see special types of matrices. So we do have symmetric matrices. Positive definite is what it has been asked in your syllabus to discuss on. And then we'll see the properties of singular value decomposition. Okay, so we'll go with one by one concept now. Okay, so what is matrices? So you all know the definition of the matrix, I feel. So let us fastly look into that. So a matrix is defined as a rectangular array of numbers or functions enclosed in brackets, and these number functions are called as entries or elements of a matrix, right? So matrix is normally a two-dimension what we call, because we do have rows and columns in any given matrix. So examples of matrix you can see in the slide, where A equals you have 1, 2, 10, minus 1, 0, and 4 are the elements of the matrix. So this matrix belongs to 2 rows and 3 columns. You can see 2 cross 3 there. And normally this type of matrices is normally called as rectangular matrix. And then we have 2 cross 2 matrix, which is a square matrix. Square matrix will always have the number of columns and rows to be equal. Okay. So you can see this A and B are both belongs to the square matrix, because we have 2 rows and 2 columns. So here A, B, C, D are the elements of the matrix. Here e power x, x plus 3, e power 3x, and x square plus 4 are the elements of the rows and column elements of the given matrix B. Okay. We can also have a row matrix or a row vector, what we call. When we have a row vector, it means that we do have one row, one single row in any given matrix. And it can have any number of columns, but we do have one row in a given matrix, and that is actually called as row matrix, which is row vector. So in this particular example, you can see we have one row with an element a1, a2, a3, whereas a1 belongs to first column, a2 belongs to second, and a3 belongs to 3. Therefore, we have one row and 3 columns here. Similarly, we have matrix B here, which is a column vector, we call it as, because it will always have only one single column, whereas n number of rows that we can see in column matrix or column vector. So here you can see an example here, B1, B2, B3 are in the first column. Okay, single column what we have, whereas B1 belongs to first row, B2 belongs to second row, and B3 belongs to third row. Therefore, this matrix has 3 rows and 1 column. That is the reason why anywhere you see one row is always called as row matrix or row vector. And if you have one column, then we normally call it as a column vector or column matrix. So if you speak in general, a matrix A would be equal to A, JK, M cross N. So the K belongs to the number where the element position is, right? So A, JK, M cross N, where J and K both are the numbers which is related to the element's position, where J says the row number, whereas K says the column number. Okay, where M and N, where M is number of rows and N is number of columns. Okay, application of matrices normally, anywhere you go, we do have a lot of applications using matrices. Normally, any mathematical model that we actually come across in any of our telecommunication techniques that we use. When we normally go with mathematical modeling, then we normally use matrices representation only. For example, MATLAB software, what do people use? It is Matrix Laboratory, is the full form of MATLAB, where matrices operations is what which we need in MATLAB to be to learn, so that you can do any operations in MATLAB. Similarly, you see in accounts, or you see anywhere where when you see mathematical model, matrix operation is one which is very simple to solve. So therefore, we normally go with matrix representations. So here, for example, if you find out the sales figures of any stationery shop, for example, the product one is notebooks, product two is pen, and product three is pencil box. So if I arrange that sales of that three particular products in from Monday to Saturday, so can I say that Monday 10 notebooks were sold, 3 pens were sold, and 4 pencils were sold? Similarly, in Tuesday we have 12 notebooks, 6 pens, and 7 pencil box. So the row gives, see the beautiness of representing in the matrix. The reason of writing in the matrix, because if you go column wise, you can find out the first element in the column one is always the notebook sold, and then the second is the pen sold, and the fourth is the pencil box sold. But when you go row wise, you can see the number of notebooks that has been sold every day. So 10 books were sold in Monday, 12 books were sold in Tuesday, whereas 15 books were sold in Wednesday, and 13 in Thursday, 4 in Friday, and 2 in Saturday. So this is the beautiness of matrix representation. If you go row wise, you can see a single product getting sold day wise. When you go column wise, you can see all three products getting sold every day. So this is the information what you can get in the matrix. So this is what the application of the matrix is. So if you get the beautiness of the matrix, like information is being in column and rows, then further solving it to find out the number of notebooks or pens or pencil box sold in a year would be much simpler way, rather than writing in a procedure oriented. Okay, so that is what the benefit of using matrices. Again, if you see the subject of marks of students, if you see, so subject one is maths, two is English, three is science, four is social, and if I have five students data, if I am going with one and two, maths and English, then definitely I will go with the matrices representation. So I hope you people see your results in your VTU portal, right? All those are actually representation which has been done using matrices only. Okay, so what is the transpose of a matrix, or transposition of a matrix? Very simple. When I have a matrix A with m rows and n columns, which is A, J, K, then transpose of that particular matrix A would be equal to A, K, J. So here the interchange of the row number and column number has been happened. So if you go with the matrix, if I have a matrix A is 1, 2, 4, 5, 6, 7 or 2 rows, you can see that A11 is 1, A12 is 2, A13 is 4, A21 is 5, A22 is 6, A23 is 7. So I'm going to interchange the number, row number and column number. Therefore, you can see that the first element would be 1, 1, and the second element would be 1, 2, 2, 1. A21 would be the second element here. See, at 2, 1, I'm interchanging. Earlier it was 1, 2, now it is 2, 1. So similarly, so what we are doing here is very simple, arranging row as column and column as rows, that's it. So you're interchanging the rows as columns and columns as rows. That is what the transpose is all about. Now if A transpose equals A, if the transposition of A equals A, then that matrix is normally called as a symmetric matrix. I'll repeat, if the transpose of a given matrix A would be equal to the given matrix. So here A transpose equals A, then it is symmetric matrix. Now for example, I have a matrix A which is 1, 4, 5, 4, 2, 6 and 5, 6, 3, which are written row wise. So diagonal of the matrix is 1, 2, 3. Normally you all know what is diagonal, right? This is the principal diagonal, what we call it as. So 1, 2, 3 is the diagonal of the matrix which we normally solve. Okay, so A transpose would be row column written as row, so 1, 4, 5 is the first column, so I'll write it as 1, 4, 5. 4 to 6 is the second column, I'll write in a row 4 to 6. 5, 6, 3 is the third column, so I'll write in a row wise 5, 6, 3. Now you see this matrix is equal to the matrix A. Therefore, this matrix is normally called as a symmetric matrix. So you find out the transpose of A, and if you get back A, then those matrix is called as symmetric matrix. Now, coming to A transpose, if A transpose equals minus A, then we call it as minus 1 into A, which is we call it as Q symmetric matrix. Now here you see 0, minus 1, 2, 1, 0, 3, minus 2, minus 3, 0 are the elements of this matrix. Now I'll write the column in terms of row here. So 0, 1, minus 2, I'll write 0, 1, minus 2, minus 1, 0, minus 3, minus 1, 0, minus 3, 2, 3, 0, 2, 3, 0. So I have written in the row wise. Both are simple, both are same. The elements, if you see, both are same, but the sign of the element is interchanged. It means that whatever the positive here, it became minus A. So therefore, I can say that A transpose equals minus A. Therefore, if you have A transpose equals minus A, those matrix is normally called as Q symmetric matrix. I'll repeat, Q symmetric matrix you get when A transpose equals minus A. Coming to the diagonal matrix. So diagonal matrix will always have the diagonal elements and all other elements would be equal to 0. So this is the example of diagonal matrix what you can see here. So you have diagonal elements which is 1, 2, 3 where all other elements are zeros. So similarly scalar matrix, you have scalar matrix where all three elements of the diagonal matrix is all equal. So it is 2, 2, 2 where all other elements are zeros. So similar to identity matrix. So here in scalar matrix you can take 2 common. So this becomes 2 into identity matrix. That is what scalar matrix is all. So your identity matrix is what? You all know that what is identity matrix, right? The diagonal elements will always be equal to 1. And all other elements will be equal to 0. Okay? So this is the identity matrix. We do have upper triangular matrix, lower triangular matrix and all. We will see that stage by stage later. So these are the various types of matrices, normal matrices we come across in matrix related operations always. Okay, what is the scalar multiplication? You take any scalar element, scalar means some value, you are going to multiply that to matrix, then that is called a scalar multiplication. Now if I have A, M cross N equals AJK, now think that C is a scalar element that I have, then if I multiply C with the matrix A, it is nothing but writing in this representation. C multiplied by AJK means you are multiplying the element C with every elements of the matrix. So think that C equals 2 and I am multiplying with this particular matrix 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 0. So what is this? 2 into 1 is 2. 2 into 2 is 4. 2 into 3 is 6. 2 into 4 is 8. 2 into 5 is 10. 2 into 6 is 12. 14, 16 and 0. So it means that you are multiplying every element of the matrix with the scalar element which is C, which is equal to 2. I hope you got it. What is scalar? Multiplication in the matrix. Matrix addition. So matrix addition. So here we have two different matrices, which is A with M cross N, M rows and N columns, which is AJK, and C is M cross N, which is C JK with M and N number of rows and number of columns. Here B is there, which is BJK, which is R into P, where R is the number of rows and P is number of columns. So here we should know one thing, the matrix addition is possible. The matrix addition is possible only when M equals R and N equals P. Only when the row number of both the matrices are equal and the column number of both the matrices are equal, then only you can add two different matrices. Understood? So here when M equals R and N equals P, then only you can add two different matrices A and B. The result is what? C matrix is what the result. So therefore CJK equals AJK plus BJK provided M equals R and N equals P. I hope you got it, right? This is what matrix addition is all. Okay, now let us look fast into laws of matrices. So you all know what are the rules that we come across in matrices. So first one is commutative law, which says A plus B equals B plus A. Then we have associative law, where A plus B whole thing added with C equals A added with B plus C. So this is associative law, where A, B are two different matrices, A, B, C are three different matrices. Now we do have scalar elements C1 and C2. If you multiply C1 with first you multiply C2 with A, and then you multiply that with C1, that would be equal to the result when you get by multiplying C1 with A, and the whole result is multiplied with C2, and this in turn can be equated to C1 C2 into A. Okay, so this is where C1 C2 are scalar elements. So this is the law which you can see for scalar multiplication. Now the next law is very important, which you should use in many places. So A plus B the whole transpose equals A transpose plus B transpose. So you add both matrix A and B and take the transpose of that, that would be equal to the individual transpose addition. Okay, so if you take A transpose and then you take B transpose, add that two, that would be equal to the total transpose that you get when you add that two different matrices A and B. Similarly, if you add two scalar elements, which is C1 and C2, and you multiply that scalar value with A, that would be equal to the addition of individual scalar element multiplied by the matrices. Like C1 into A plus C2 into A would be equal to C1 plus C2, the whole multiplied by A. Similarly, you have C into A, the whole transpose, that would be equal to C into A transpose. So you multiply C and A and then take whole transpose. That is also equal to multiplying the scalar element C with the transpose of the matrix A. Similarly, you have C into A plus B, so you add A and B and then you multiply with C, that would be also equal to multiplying the scalar element to the individual matrix A and B and then adding the two different values. So then you have matrix A with 0, adding will give you again A matrix, where 0 is again a 0 matrix which we have here. So then again A plus of minus A would be equal to 0, because all the element gets subtracted, where that so the same element getting subtracted will definitely give you a 0 matrix. Multiplying A, B will never be equal to B into A. Very, very important. See here, multiplying matrix A first with B will never be equal to, if you interchange the multiplication way, if you multiply B with A, then that will never be equal to multiplication of AB. That is very important. But there is another funda here, which is with very beautiness with multiplication factor here. So if you multiply A and B and take the transpose of that, that would be equal to B transpose into A transpose. So you should remember this rules of matrices. Very, very important. So you directly multiply AB, then that will never be equal to B into A. But if you take AB transpose, then that would be equal to B transpose into A transpose. Okay, examples, if you have A equals 1, 2, 3, 4 and B equals 2, 3, 4, 5, A plus B is 3, 5, 7, 9 and B plus A is 3, 5, 7, 9 again, therefore A plus B equals B plus A. Similarly, you have A equals this and B equals this and C equals this. Take A plus B and add that with C, you get the same value. You take B plus C, adding element by element, that's it. So A plus B means 1 plus 2. This is 2 plus 3, 3 plus 4, 4 plus 5, that is what you are going to do. So you add with C, then again you get 4, 5, 5, 7, 10. Then you add B and C, you get this matrix, and add that again with A here, and again you get 4, 5, 7, 10, therefore these both are equal. Similarly, you can prove all the laws that you come across in the properties which you have seen earlier. So for example, you have scalar elements C1 and C2, which is 1 and 2. A equals 1, 2, 3, 4. So you multiply C2 with A. So 2 into 1 is 2, 2 into 2 is 4, 2 into 3 is 6, and 2 into 4 is 8. So you get C2 into A is this. Multiply that with C1, you get 2, 4, 6, 8 again. Okay. So C1 into A, you do 1, 2, 3, 4, you get. And C1 into A into C2, you get 2, 4, 6, 8. Therefore, these both are equal. So similarly, you can go with A plus B transpose. So you have A and B here. A plus B is 3, 5, 7, 9. So transpose, if you take 3, 7, 5, 9. Now you take A transpose, which is 1, 3, 2, 4, you get. So 1, 3, 2, 4. B transpose, you take 2, 4, 3, 5. You get 2, 4, 3, 5 here. If you add both, you again get 3, 7, 5, 9. And that is equal to A plus B transpose. Okay, so matrix multiplication is again very, very important. You need to know this. So earlier we saw scalar multiplication, where scalar element getting multiplied with one single matrix. Now your matrix multiplication is you are multiplying two different matrices, where A is a matrix with m rows and n columns, where B is the matrix with r rows and p columns. You can multiply two different matrices only when their column numbers are equal. Very, very important property which I am telling you, m cross n and r cross p, here n should be equal to r. It means that n is equal to r is not column numbers, I'm sorry. The matrix A column number should be equal to the matrix B row number. Okay. So n is equal to r. Here n is number of columns in matrix A, where here r is number of rows in column B. Therefore n should be equal to r, where number of columns of A should be equal to number of rows of B. Then only you can multiply A and B, and that result is C. So n and r gets cancelled, you get the result with dimension m cross P. Okay, so that is how you can do matrix multiplication. So here if AB equals 0 does not necessarily imply A equals 0 comma B equals 0 or BA equals 0. Okay, so if A into B equals 0, it doesn't mean that whether A is equal to 0 or B equal to 0 or BA equal to 0. It depends on the elements, it depends on the matrix elements that we have. B might be 0, but A cannot be 0. So, or A can be 0 and B might not be 0. Okay, so it depends on the elements of the matrix. If AC equals AD, that it does not necessarily imply that C equals D. Okay, so you should know. AC equals AD means I can cancel A and you say that C equals D. No, it is not like that. It does not necessarily imply that C is equal to D. Okay, keep that in mind. But when you multiply CA, which is C is the scalar element here, when you multiply CA into B, which is equal to A into CB, then it is CAB. So this multiplication rule will be satisfied. Similarly, A into BC would be equal to AB into C. Similarly, A into B plus C would be equal to AB plus AC. So all these rules, these three rules will definitely satisfy in matrix multiplication. AS equals S into A, where S is the scalar matrix, where S equals C 0 0 0 C 0 0 0 C, then definitely you can say that matrix result would be C into A. That is possible. That is possible. Okay, this is possible. Provided S equals a scalar matrix with all principal diagonal elements are C. Okay, coming to triangular matrix. So I told you earlier that we will look into upper and lower triangular matrix later. So let us see what is upper triangular matrix. Upper triangular matrix is the elements above the principal diagonal elements. So your principal diagonal elements is 1, 4, 6. The elements above the principal diagonal elements are all non-zero elements. And any one element can also be 0. That doesn't mean that it should be all non-zero. But the elements below the principal diagonal should always be all 0. That is what you need to know. So the elements below the principal diagonal element should all be 0 for upper triangular matrix. Similarly, for lower triangular matrix, the elements above the principal diagonal, see, this is the principal diagonal and this is the below elements for upper triangular, which is all zeros. Similarly, for lower triangular, the elements above the principal diagonal, the elements above the principal diagonal should all be 0. So this is an example of 3 cross 3 matrix, where you can see 0, 0, 0. So these are the 3 elements which is below the principal diagonal, therefore that comes under the upper triangular. Similarly, here 1, 3, 6 is the principal diagonal. Above the principal diagonal is, you can see these 3 zeros, and that comes with the family of lower triangular matrix. Okay. So I assume that you people have got what is upper triangular and lower triangular matrix. Okay. Multiplication of row vector and column vector. As I said earlier, row vector means we do have one row and n columns. Similarly, column vector means we have n rows and one columns. So if you multiply these two, you get a matrix with the dimension 1 cross 1. You get a matrix with the dimension 1 cross 1. It means you will have one row and one column. See the beautiness. You multiply two different matrices, which is row vector and column vector. Finally, you get a result with one row and one column. It means what? You just get a single element in the result. You just get single element. So one row, one column. One row, one column is you will just get a single element as a result here. Similarly, if you do column vector multiplied by the row vector, Again, you see the beautiness here. If you multiply column vector and row vector, you get n row and n columns. Okay, you will get n row and n columns. That is why I have not represented any dimension here. You will get n rows and n columns. So one gets cancelled. So the result will be n cross n dimension. So here 1 cross 1 dimension, here you get n cross n dimension, where n is the number of elements, number of rows and columns, the number of the result n cross n will say n rows and n columns in the result. Okay, that is what it means. So for example, you have 1 2 3 is the, what is this 1 2 3? It's a row vector, and b equals 4 5 6 is a column vector. If you multiply these two, what do you get? You get 32. See, this is 1 cross 1 matrix. 32 is 1 cross 1 matrix. So how do you got 1 into 4 plus 5 into 2 plus 6 into 3? 18 plus 10, 28 plus 4, 32. So that is what 32 here. Similarly, B equals 4, 5, 6 is a column matrix, column vector, where A is 1, 2, 3 is a row vector. If you multiply these two, 4 into 1 is 4, 4 into 2 is 8, 4 into 3 is 12. Similarly, 5 into 1 is 5, 5 into 2 is 10, 6 into 3 is 18. So this should be 18, I am sorry. 5 into 3 is 15, okay. 6 into 1 is 6, 6 into 2 is 12, 6 into 3 is 18, okay. So you got, this is the matrix. Now, what do you got? See here, we have 3 rows and 1 columns. Here we have 1 row and 3 columns. So 3 into 1, 1 into 3. Therefore, the result is 3 cross 3. So here, 1 row and 3 columns. So 1 cross 3. Here 3 rows and 1 columns, 3 cross 1. So 1 cross 3, 3 cross 1, so 1 cross 1. So I hope now you are fine with row vector and column vector, column vector and row vector multiplication. What would be the dimension of the result that you get? Okay, so anyway, dot product or inner product, you have A into B equals A into B transpose, and that is what you get. That is what you can use the formula here. See, here A, and this is B column, so that is B transpose what we have. Here we have B and here we have A. So that is what, A into B transpose. B transpose is what? Earlier you will have 4, 5, 6 in row and you take it in column. That is what. Okay. Now the next very important thing is echelon form of a matrix. I hope this echelon form I already discussed even in the vector space. The same thing again, you can recall it even in matrix chapter also. So a matrix is said to be in echelon form if the following conditions are satisfied. What is that? See, a matrix is said to be in echelon form if the following conditions are satisfied. All zero rows should be at the bottom of the matrix. See, very very important. All zero rows should be at the bottom of the matrix. All the leading non-zero entries in a row are to the right of the zero entries. It should be right. All the leading non-zero entries in a row are to be right of the zero entries. All elements in a column below a leading coefficients are zero. All elements in a column below a leading coefficients are zero. Okay, all elements in a column below a leading coefficients are zero. So again, we'll read these three rules. All zero rows should be at the bottom of the matrix. So it should be, means last rows should all be zero rows. That is what it means. All the leading non-zero entries in a row are to be at the right of the zero entries. It means that in any row, if you take, all the zero entries should be in the beginning and all the non-zero entries should be at the last in any rows. And third one is all elements in a column below a leading coefficients are zero. So in any column wise, if you take, the first elements of the column should always be non-zero entries, and then you see all zeros will come after the non-zero entries. The another main thing which you need to know, the before getting into echelon form, we'll see the examples now. But before that, we'll see what is pivots and pivotal elements. So the pivots of a matrix are the first non-zero elements in a matrix in its echelon form. So we'll have an echelon form of any matrix. So if you see what are the pivots of that particular echelon form of a matrix, we'll say the pivots of a matrix are the first non-zero element in a matrix in its echelon form. So first non-zero element in any matrix in its echelon form, then that is actually pivot or pivots elements. Now coming to rank of a matrix. In an echelon form of a matrix, the number of non-zero rows defines the rank of the matrix. I hope this we have seen even in the vector spaces also, we have seen what is rank of a matrix. So the rank of a matrix is what? In an echelon form of a matrix, the number of non-zero rows, if you have non-zero rows in any rows, in any given matrix, then that particular number of rows will be equal to the rank of that particular matrix. Okay, example, you can see here example. Now tell me what is pivots. So you just look into the example, what is pivots? Okay, so now I hope you people have got what is pivots, right? So the non-zero entries, what is that? 4 is in the first row, so 4 will be the first pivot. And see, after first 0 you have 6, which is the second pivot. So 4 comma 6 would be the 2 pivots element. So you got pivots, right? So 4 is first pivot and 6 is the second pivot, because after 0 you should take. Now coming to rank of this matrix, we don't have all 0 elements in any row, therefore rank would be equal to 2. So these 2 rows are considered as non-zero element rows. Okay, so therefore rank of the matrix is, though you do have one single 0 here, but still you have 6 and 8 in that particular row, therefore you have rank of this particular matrix is 2. Similarly here, matrix B is 2, 1, minus 3, 5, 0, 5, minus 1, 15. So whatever I read the matrix, I always read it in row wise, okay? So 0, 5, minus 1, 15, 0, 0, minus 4 and 12. So if I ask you what are the pivots of this particular matrix, so 2 is the first pivot, 5 is the second pivot, minus 4. Why? Because it comes after 0 here. You can see the first element after 0 is always pivot. So 2, 5 and minus 4 are the pivots. What about the rank? Rank is very simple, though you have zeros here, but still we have non-zero elements in any row if you take, therefore the rank of the matrix B would be equal to 3. Now coming to the matrix C, so what are the pivots in matrix C here is, 2 is the first pivot in first row, 8 is the second pivot, and then again you have 2 is the third pivot, and last row is all zeros, therefore there you don't find any pivots there. But coming to rank of the matrix is very important, which you need to see now. The last row is all zeros. So that row will not be considered for the rank. Therefore the rank of the matrix C, though we do have 3 zeros in the third row, but we still have non-zero elements in the third row. Therefore the rank of the matrix C would be equal to 3 row. 3 would be equal to the rank of the matrix C. Similarly, the rank of the matrix D is 2, because we have 2 rows with non-zero elements. Whereas pivot, if you say, minus 3 is the first pivot and 2 is the second pivot. Always in the first row, it need not to be start with 0. So we consider always the first element of the particular row would be the first pivot. Okay. Whereas when you find out the element non-zero pivot in the subsequent elements or the rows, you will always go with the element which starts after zeros. Now your pivots will be found only if you try to convert the matrix in this form. You can't just find out pivots in any given matrix. You should convert the matrix in this Euclidean form. So these all are Euclidean form matrices that you can see in the example. Okay. Okay. Now find the rank of the following matrices. So what would be the rank of the following matrices? So for this, you need to convert into an Euclidean form. So for that we need to do some row operations. So this would be like a puzzle. Row operations is always you should think on applying it, and you should know how to apply the row operation, and you should always judge how simple it can be applied so that the solution can be obtained in the very least steps. Okay, so number of steps should be reduced. So you can apply row operation however you want, but the applying row operation should always reduce the number of steps to obtain the Euclidean form. That is the major thing you should always think in finding out the Euclidean form. So this is all what method it is. Jordan, I hope you remember Gaussian Jordan method which we normally saw in vector space. So same thing we are applying here to convert into Euclidean form. So here R2 is R2 minus 2 R1 is what we go with, because when I say R2 is this, see in the first row you see 4, 2, 3 is just a multiplication of 2, it will make all 3 elements of the second row to be equal to 0. So therefore don't make first row to be equal to 0, that is a wrong method. First row should always be non-zero, subsequent row should become 0, not the first row. So you should keep this in mind. So therefore the second row will always be 0 if you use this formula R2 equals R2 minus 2 times R1. Okay. So therefore when you subtract so the second row is all zeros now. Now let us go with the next step. What we can see, so the third row becomes all 0. So very simple, R3 will be 2 times R3 plus R1. See this 2 times R3 plus R1. See here 4, 2, 3, 2, 1 minus 1.5. So 2 times R1 was R2. Now 2 times R3 would be equal to R1. Therefore R3 would be equal to 2 times R3 plus R1, because all are minus, so you are adding with R1. So therefore the third row will also become all zeros. So once you got this Euclidean form, I hope further you need not to reduce it, because first row is all non-zeros, whereas subsequent rows are all became all zeros. So further operation is not required. You are ending up with this particular matrix, where this is the Euclidean form matrix which you have got at the final stage. Therefore, what would be the rank of the given matrix here? You have only first element, first row which is non-zeros, whereas other two rows are all zeros. Therefore, the rank of the given matrix would be equal to 1. So similarly, let us go with the next problem. You have A, which is 1 5 4 0 3 2 2 13 10, B is 1 1 1 2 2 2 3 3 3. So you need to find out question here is R of A and R of B. Second part of the question is you need to find out R is rank of A and rank of B, rank of A plus B, rank of AB and rank of BA. So let us look into the solution now. First we'll see how to find out the rank of A. So A is given in this particular form. So you need to think what row operation I can apply so that the Euclidean form is obtained. So here you see R3 equals R3 minus 2 times R1. So here I can't make all three elements at a time to be equal to 0, because we don't have an option like how we had in the previous problem. So you need to see how to make 0 of these two elements first, and then we'll go with these two elements, and then we go with these two elements. Okay, always you go with this and this element, and then these two elements if it can become 0, and then finally go with these two elements. Okay, so therefore here this element is already 0, so let me see whether I can make this or these two elements to be equal to 0. So how is that? So for that I will go with R3 minus 2 times R1. If I do this operation, I'll see that the second row and third row will become both equal. So second and third row will become both equal. Then I can make one of the row to be equal to all zeros. Okay. So therefore R3 equals R3 minus 2 R1 will give me 0, 3, 2 in R3. Whereas when I take R3 would be equal to R3 minus R2, I'll get all zeros in the third row. Okay, but you can't make all zeros in the second row. Further operations if you do, it will try to change this element to be equal to non-zero. So you should stop here. So this is the final Euclidean matrix of matrix A when you take. Therefore rank of this matrix A would be equal to 2. So similarly, if you take the B, so the B is given as 1 1 1 2 2 2 3 3 3. Very simple. First you should do R3 minus 3 times R1. So R3 is what? 0, 0, 0 you get, because 3, 3, 3 minus 3 times 1, 1, 1. So it will give you 0, 0, 0 in R3. Similarly, very simple, R2 equals R2 minus 2 times R1. So 2, 2, 2 minus 2 times 1, 1, 1. So it will all make 0, 0, 0. Therefore, rank of B would be equal to 1. So what is rank of A plus B? So first you need to find out what is A plus B. So A plus B is adding two different matrices. You get 2, 6, 5, 2, 5, 4, 5, 16, 13. Then you see, can we further convert this into Euclidean form? So it is quite difficult to convert this into Euclidean form. So therefore, we will try to do R2 equals R2 minus R1. We will see that only one of this element becomes 0, whereas all other elements will remain as it is. The reason is, see, 13 is not multiplied by any element. Right, so 5 is again, it is not multiplied by any element. You have another 5 here which is not multiplied by any element. So therefore you can somehow say the further operation is not required. Therefore, rank of A plus B will definitely be equal to 3. Because why we have went done further? Because further if you do, still rank remains same only. So here in this question they have asked only to find out the rank. So one further, if you can further continue with the operations if you want, but unfortunately at the end of the operation that you do, final Euclidean form will always show the rank of A plus B will be equal to 3. Therefore, you can just imagine what would be the further operation, and if you feel that you can do further and if you can reduce the rank value, then you can further go and reduce it. But further if you reduce and still rank remains same, which is 3, then you can just say that it is equal to 3. Now coming to A into B is what you multiply A and B. So here multiplied value of A and B, you all know how to do matrix multiplication. So AB will be equal to 23, 23, 23, 12, 12, 12, 58, 58, 58. Definitely, what would be the matrix rank now? So anyone can say that the matrix rank will definitely be equal to, would be equal to 1. Why? Because you can see that all the elements in the first row are equal, all the elements in the second row are equal, all the elements in the third row are equal. Therefore, you can easily say that the rank of this particular matrix would be equal to 1. For somehow you can do further steps if you want. This is what you get. This is what you get. I hope you are clear with the rank calculation of any given matrix, right? And how to get a clear form also. Alright, now we will see what is determinants. So, still now whatever we have covered is basics on matrices. Now we will see what is determinants and let us see what are the properties that we come across in determinants. Okay. Alright, so this discussion on determinants will be discussed in my next video. Please do watch. I hope till now whatever we have discussed on matrices is clear to you. So we'll see in the next video what is determinants, and we'll see some examples of determinants, and we'll see how to calculate the cofactors, we'll see what is permutations in the matrices, and then we'll keep our step into eigenvalues and eigenvectors.